skating or over riding the speed of the time, the way express one's cool place, cool way of managing speed. We all have an opportunity to ride all of that that's on the ballot. Right, we call something that everybody was standing behind a red light and blue curtain, voted yes or no. I'm sure maybe we had some more experience. Maybe we felt that an absentee ballot. If you didn't like that one, that's fine. I'm okay with that. But if you did question, did follow on our ballot question today, and did work to turn over many voters to your position. I'm guessing not, because there's never been an opposition to all that cause. Maybe put out a homie sign on their lawn, throw a letter to the editor. If you did, pray with the support in the democratic process. I exercise your right to vote in the election. There's a chance you were here when the legislature voted for these questions on the ballot in the past. I went back and pulled out some active votes required two-thirds majority from 2009 and 2012. In each case, the cause grabbed more votes than needed for enactment. That was a dead opportunity to vote for these ones. What I'm getting at is that this is how the process works. There are times I like the outcomes of bond issue and other times I don't. I accept it because I appreciate the concept that the lower majority of voters should always trump my own. And when I happen to vote on the side of the majority, which doesn't generally happen when I vote on the ones, I should have the expectation that my will in that case be followed. Now, it's kind of a reminder just as any individual with a plan for Maine's future, Peter's a cousin. He has every individual to honor our voters' wishes and all voters, and all voters are responsible for the governments. Overriding this veto will put those fiduciary reasons in place for not issuing a move or approved bond. It strips away arbitrary reasons. That's all it does. It does not hand that power over to the state treasurer. I owe my constituents that and the voters. I owe them all my life and Mr. Speaker.
Chair Geiser, Representative Burlington, Representative Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, I rise to sustain this veto. I serve on the state local government committee and heard this bill. At the time, we heard from a number of special interest groups in support of this bill. They all had similar talking points. This bill needs to be enacted to protect the lands for Maine future programs. I respect each branch of government, and each has a separate role in bond and authority. It has been that way for a very long time and should continue. This session, we had a bond that expired, and we, the legislature, voted to extend that bond. The voter's intent of that bond is being carried out because we acted to do so. That authority is already in place, and it worked just the way it should have. We, the legislature, can exercise that authority if need be on any bonds, such as Lands for Maine's Future. I can appreciate the need to support the Lands for Maine's Future program. That, however, is not what this bill does. This bill applies to the process of the issuance of all general obligation bills. This makes a major change in the balance of power between two branches of government. Making broad policy changes for specific situations often results in unintended consequences. I support Lands for Maine's Future, but I cannot support this radical change. I ask you please vote rep on this pending motion. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair Geiser, move forward to that.
Thank you, Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House. This certainly has been one of the most hotly debated and contested bills in the Senate. And I just want to start off by indicating that I originally voted for this bond back in 2010, back in line with the 2015 legislature. And so, certainly, I think by that vote, my support for the Lands for Maine's Future program is certainly not in question. And I will indicate that throughout this session, I have attended and have had a minimum of three meetings in my office with some of the players involved in this to try to bring people to a consensus on solving this issue. And I think it is an issue that can be resolved. However, I think what this particular bill does is it it tries to marry two very separate issues into one bill, and I think that is where the fatal flaw is in this particular bill. Because this isn't just about the land surveying future. And again, I support that program, but I do not support this bill. Because the second part of this bill addresses a very significant shift. And I'll say that again, a very significant shift in trying to remove the chief executive from what I believe our constitutional framers believe was a very important role and function for our chief executive. And so, on that basis, I can support this bill. So I'm going to ask those of you that agree with that analysis, vote the same way. And that no, your vote should not be interpreted as a no vote for Lance or Maine's future. Because that is a misconstruction, it is a misrepresentation, I believe, of many of the votes that people will say, I'm going to vote to sustain this particular veto. It's not because we don't support the Lance or Maine's future, because I think many of us do. I'm going to read you a quote today from an interview that I understand that was on the radio this morning from a former chief executive, Governor Maldonado. And it reads as follows, quote, what happened with the bond issue in particular, you may see legislation passed that will restrict the executive much more so because of what's occurred. And I think that's something that area really does concern me. I think it's about the next government and the next administration and their abilities. You have situations occurring because you have a part-time citizen legislature, and you need to have a strong executive because they're going to be there year-round, but the legislature is only there 3, 4, or 5 months. You may have a mill closing. You may have a public safety issue. You may need to have those emergency powers instituted. And I think it calls upon a governor and a single chief executive of the state, and I hate to see those powers being eroded. I think we all recognize, end quote, I think we all recognize that Governor Baldacci certainly was a member of the other party. But I think it's instructive when you have a former chief executive, in my opinion, my interpretation of that being, agree with the veto letter, essentially the position of our current chief executive. So, let me be clear as I conclude my comments. I will vote to sustain this veto because, number one, I do support the Lance Maine Future Program, but number two, I don't support taking powers away from or having a significant shift from the chief executive to what might just become a state treasurer that gets elected by this one. And that's a pretty significant shift to take something from the executive branch and to shift it over to the legislative branch. And so I believe we have the opportunity, ladies and gentlemen of the House, I believe we have an opportunity to work over the summer and the fall, and when we come back in the spring, to continue to work on this issue. I commit myself to continuing to do that as I did throughout this session. If we will work on this, and we'll get it right. I honestly believe at the end of the day, we are going to get this right. But I'm asking you to have faith in that and to follow my life. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Sure, guys, Representative.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, men and women of the House. First of all, I want to stand and rise and thank the good representative from Newport, Representative Fredette, for attempting to address this issue. We met several times over the session with stakeholders from the Nature Conservancy, stakeholders from land trust organizations, Republicans and Democrats joining together to try to move this issue forward. We were also joined by the executive director of the Sportsman's Alliance of Maine. But one thing was clear, meeting after meeting, was that the issue was not moving forward, that there wasn't any give from the second floor and the chief executive. We have a bill before us. This is a bipartisan bill. This is a bill that on June 11th received a vote of 103 members. I stand corrected, 102 members that were present and voting in favor of this bill. So nothing has changed. If it was someone different on the second floor that was using these bonds for a political tool, maybe even a former governor.
Objection, Mr. Speaker.
Representative Byrd. Jerry Byers, Representative Byrd.
Because I believe the good representative from South Eden, especially the bonus of the chief executive, he's out of work.
Mr. Chair, my member remarks to the content that is before us under consideration to be a person of seat.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I don't intend to question the motives of the chief executive, and happy to sort of back up history a little bit. I would draw everyone's attention to back in June of 2013, a quote that said, "As a measure of good faith, I am hereby directing the state treasurer to begin to prepare those bonds for my signature on an expedited basis." That was in regards to the LMF bonds. That was in regards to us paying back the hospital debt, and these bonds were supposed to be released at that time. So here we are, July 16th, 2015, and these bonds have not been released. So this is not an issue of bonds expiring. This is not an issue of whether or not we'll be able to have an extension or not. It's about the bonds that have not been issued and that continue to be used as leverage. Mr. Speaker, let's be honest here. We watch today, we look in the back of this chamber, and the room is filled. The room is filled with folks who are working this bill. I haven't seen a bill work this hard in some time. There's folks on both sides of this aisle, Mr. Speaker, who've been promised many, many things. They've been promised that if they don't sustain this veto, they'll lose out on a project that's in their district. We've also heard that if folks vote to sustain this veto, their project will be expedited. So let's be honest here. We are voting to move this issue forward, whether it's LMF or some other bond. I've been here before, Mr. Speaker. It's deja vu for me. This happened before with our downtown bonds. Here we are again. These bonds are being held. This time it's LMF bonds. I really want folks to think about this. I hope folks picked up the paper today and read the newspaper, whether it was the Bangor Daily, whether it was the Sun Journal, whether it was the Morning Sentinel. Each of these papers had an op-ed or an editorial from folks, not just the editorial boards, Mr. Speaker, but from real people. One of the best op-eds I've seen all session came today by David Trahan. The Honorable David Trahan, the Executive Director of SAM, laid out a timeline for LMF, laid out a timeline of what's happening. Also debunked a lot of the myths. We heard a lot about LMF bonds having to do with rich and poor. Let's face it, Mr. Speaker, these LMF bonds are about access. They provide access for men and women to work. They provide access for families like mine and like yours to access things like fishing grounds, hunting grounds, waterfront access. So let's be honest today. Our vote is much more about the actual issue of releasing these bonds, which, obviously, back on June 11th, 102 of us agreed that that was a good thing. Nothing's changed right now. As we talk about things related to bond rating, let me tell you, Mr. Speaker, in the day and age of Google, all any bond rating house has to do is Google Maine and bonds, and they'll see what's going on here in Maine. That is a sure sign that that right there should be a ding on our credit. Time after time, the last 2-3 years, these bonds have become nothing more than political leverage. So, Mr. Speaker, I would encourage folks to take a stand today, vote to override this. There was also a great op-ed today. David Trahan's listed on this one as well. There's a piece, this was in the Morning Sentinel, Kennebec Journal. Also, Marilyn Meyerhand. Anybody that knows Marilyn Meyerhand knows that she is a hard-working woman. She's headed up an apple farm, actually two apple farms now, for a number of years. It's right over the border. It's not in my district. One of them, it's over in the town of Fairfield. It's over in the good representative from Fairfield, Representative Pashotti's district. And Marilyn Meyerhand's somebody that's not a big fan of regulations. I would describe her as a good libertarian. So when Marilyn Meyerhand contacts me, that means something to me. I listen. She's quoted today. There's a blue sheet that went around, Mr. Speaker. You can actually read her comments. Unbelievable comments today. There's also comments in the paper from fishermen, men and women, who fish, who need access, waterfront access. So I've also heard comments on the radio today that there's no project in jeopardy. And I know, Mr. Speaker, there's people on both sides of this aisle have heard from constituents. I've probably heard from more constituents on this issue than any one issue this year. It's clear. Folks want these bonds released. We have an opportunity today to make a stand, to make a statement. And I would encourage all 102 people who voted yes before to continue with that vote, because nothing has changed. Except right now, it's a veto override. And let's face it, folks, promises have been made and promises have been broken. So if you've been promised something in the last day or the last week, I encourage you to think about that. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair, can I represent Mr. Sinclair and Mr. Martin?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, I know that some of you have heard me say this, shared this with you before, but I had the opportunity for 8 years to serve on the LF board under the previous administration. I've had the opportunity to experience the good work that this fine group of men and women did for 8 years, and I've had an opportunity to visit so many sites and parcels of land in great recreational areas that purchased by the fronts. I view this next vote as supporting the will of the voters. As the previous speaker just mentioned, this was in fact committed to the Committee of State and Local Government, and I'm calling one of the gentlemen who testified in opposition to the bill 1378 saying, you know, you've got to vote this now, like committee members, because this goes against the grain and the will of the governor. And my response as House Chair of this fine committee was, are we not going against the will of the voters by holding these bonds here? One thing that really concerned me was a recent remark here where the governor said that LMF bonds that benefited only the rich and wealthy. Again, this is truly false in my opinion. This benefits farmers, fishermen, sportsmen, and women from around Maine that specifies how it's important to decisions to their property. Not only in southern Maine, not only in central Maine, but in northern Maine as well. I would urge all members of this group, of this great fine House of Representatives, to vote in the affirmative on the pending motion. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chairman Brown, I'll just refer to the Chief Executive, actually the Chief Executive, the Chair, who recognize Representative Chelsea, the chance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and the women of the House. Today's committee fees may have been the catalyst for the bill, but this bill has evolved into something much more broad and much more dangerous. For years, we've had a two-signature process on the release of the bonds. It's important because of the taxpayer protection.
ignore the voting of power of the people that ballot us in Maine and ignoring their will. The people have spoken, got the ballot box, and have voted. There's no branch of government that should be able to say no to them. If we erode their power, we're eroding the essence of our democracy. Thank you.
Chair, Representative Carter, of the Denver. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, I stand before you today about LD 1378. It's not about the element bonds, it's about all bonds. It's not all bonds in the future of Maine. It's about the process. The process that has worked in the state for a number of years. This process has been delayed. Now, I don't know if anybody can question, and everybody has an opinion about how the chief executive officer comments or does things. He has his way, we have ours. But to change this process at this point in time in government, I think is bad policy. The good representative from Chelsea pointed out that the state treasurer would be the only saving grace in when the bond was issued. Well, some years, the state is voting on $245 million worth of bonds. If we went and released them every year, we would have to raise that money through the taxpayers of the state of Maine. There are times to release them and times not to release them. And there's a process in place that does that. That's through the treasurer, through the governor, and through this legislature. If we change that process, we stand a real, real great chance of doing devastation to our credit rating in the state of Maine. That would not be good, because one 2-point rise in our borrowing rate amounts to millions of dollars. We have a process that goes through appropriations, and I'm only a 1-year member there, a rookie, who has learned that we put out about $100 million or so that we expect to have to pay back in bonds every year. The treasurer is elected without getting a resume or anything else. It's a political appointment. But we all know that we've had great treasurers and bad treasurers, Republicans and Democrats on both sides have been good and been bad. And to leave that process strictly up to them in any 1 year will put this state in great danger. And I'm afraid the bond market would reference that in how they rate us. So I ask you, from the bottom of my heart, with all sincerity, please sustain the governor's veto on this. It's not about whether you like the chief executive officer or don't like the chief executive officer. This is about the process here, and I ask you to please sustain this with you today. Thank you very much.
Chair, nice representative, Representative Broker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Chairman of the House. If you'll indulge me, I'd like to read the list of projects currently approved by the Land for Maine Future Board, but as yet unfunded. You might think of these projects as stable, pending the outcome of our deliberations today. But I read this, think of these places as perhaps the luxury subdivision. Grave Oak headquarters, headwaters in Erie, Central Maine Sportsman Access in Emden, Vernon, Detroit, Cambridge, and Ripley. I do know that this is the number one area for deer tagging in the state of Maine. This project would include two public access boat launches, two lakes that are entirely private, deer yards, and waterfowl breeding areas. Caribou Conservation Area in Old Town, Clapperoy Island in Falmouth, Cold Stream Forest and West Forks Plantation, Johnson Mountain Township, Carmel Pond, Crooked River Forest and Old Steel and Harrison, Crow Island Threat Light in South Bristol, Ellis River, the White Cat Mountain in Rutherford, State Township. High Island in St. George, Howard Hill in Augusta, Kimball Pond in Sharon, Knights Pond in Cumberland, North Yarmouth, Lower West Egg Field in Forest in South Thompson, North Downs Conservation Quarter in Downs, the Riverwalk Park in Bifford, Raymond Community Forest in Raymond, Reddington Forest in Reddington Township, Roberts Farm Preserve in Norway, Eagle Bluff in Clifton, Laguna Expansion in the District of Cassin Grant in Soldertown Township, and lastly, Weston Homestead Forest in Madison. Mr. Speaker, this one's for all the marbles. What we stand for as a state. Please join me in voting affirmative and override and save plans for Maine's future.
Chair, I'd like to represent South Burr, Representative Evers.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, I wasn't intending to speak, but I have reached a conclusion after hearing all that's been said, and that is that no executive, regardless of affiliation, should ever be able to override the will of the people.
Chair, Representative Glenn Burr.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, do I think the Washington State? Yes, I do. Those of you who know me know that I'm a worker and for Maine's future Washington State. In the heat of this session, I voted for this bill. In the interim, I have had time for a closer examination of the question before us, the question of change our Constitution, the question of a two-person signature on something as vital as state laws, the question of putting our bond rating at risk. I will continue to support the release of our bonds, but I cannot, in good conscience, put our state in jeopardy. Today, I will be supporting a process that will allow the needed discretion for future governors.
Chair, can I ask Representative Schofield? Representative Powell, Representative Schofield.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House. We're speaking for my heart. I spent a career in conservation. Lands for Maine Futures program is extremely important to our state. Without it, we would see vast differences in what our people can recreate and have access. Access is important. Access is important to people who don't have the means to buy. We need the Land for Maine Futures program, and I have always been and continue to be extremely supportive of that program. I don't know. My dilemma is that I also hold near and dear to me the constitutional process that we have in the state. I hold near and dear to me the way that we are able to process all that we do and the tradition and the methods that we have used for all these many years. I really do not have a desire to see that change because we have a situation here, a short-term situation should not be rectified and made different because I think the long-term results could be devastating. So, unforeseen circumstances could arise here. So I will be reluctant, I might add, voting this
statement. Thank you. Chair, I ask Representative Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House. As we said, that the Constitution provides, this is somehow a constitutional change. It is not. I thank the Representative Marion for handing out a sheet which is on all of your desks, which summarizes what the current law is. As he states in his handout, proposal. It says nothing about the chief executive. There is no specific authority in the Constitution giving bond authority to the governor. Rather, state legislature has enacted and delegated its authority to the state treasurer, quote, under the direction of the governor, or to be more precise here, the chief executive. So, this is a statutory provision. This legislature is fully capable of state changing the statute where use of the existing statutory authority has been demonstrated, and that is the situation here. His role, the chief executive's role, would continue, but it would be limited to fiscal considerations only, and not be allowed to be used as a political weapon in a way that harms.
We strayed a little bit on the discussion on the bill that's before us, and when this vote is taken, there'll be some time, people will be making up their mind. I know there's a number of folks on the fence today. They're trying to figure out how to vote. For many of them, they voted for this bill before. There's a great deal of pressure on them today to not vote for the bill, so I encourage them to look at the bill. I've heard a lot of the opposition today in regards to the bill having to do with debt service, having to do with our credit rating. So I'd encourage folks to actually look at the bill, because it still allows for the ability, under five specific conditions, that the bonds not be released. It's just notifying the public, notifying the legislature about those reasons. So it provides clarity. It's a housekeeping measure in my mind. One of those reasons would be debt service greater. The treasurer of the state of Maine could determine that the debt service on the bond would be greater than the amount budgeted. The bond wouldn't be issued. Two, adverse impact on credit score rating. The treasurer has the ability to determine the issuance of the bonds will adversely affect the credit rating of the state. Right there, number two, that addresses much of the concern we've heard today. Three, having to do with the advantageous interest rate. The treasurer of the state of Maine can determine the delay of the issuance of the bonds will likely result in more financial advantages interest rating, advantageous interest rating, right there. Four, this is a really important one. The project is not proceeding. We heard that in a previous speaker. If the project isn't going forward, we wouldn't issue the bond. That's still included. Or number five, which is one that I really like, and it's that if alternative funding is available. So if we determine that the money is not needed, there's another source The bond doesn't need to be sold. So I encourage folks to think about that. I encourage folks to go online, ask for a copy of the bill, but make sure you know what you're voting for today. You've been told a lot of things in the hallway. You've received some emails. But really, just take a look at the bill. This is really about good governance, and it's about the will of the people. So thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
The roll call is in order. For the Constitution, vote for the yeas and nays. Sorry, Mr. Chair of the House, vote yes in favor of the bill. Vote no in favor of the state of the governor's constitutional question. Chair, vote.
Sure, we'll go for the social council. Then you want to go first?
meetings.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Democrats will caucus immediately following the recess for a very brief caucus in appropriations, so please get down there. We have a couple items to talk about, and then we will come back up here.
How many of them are down?
For this body, to look at posing the question to the Supreme Judicial Court
common solemnification as is permitted under the Maine Constitution. And I so request that, Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
Chair, I formally represent the group of the representative that in order to do that, House will need to be intercepted. Chair, I'd like to vote out supplement number four, receive the petition of bills and results prior to reference to any committee.
Thank you, as well as the minutes. So, the question four is already authorized to announce the 2009 violation of the Maine Conservation Project. The appropriation plan is of very specific and
important. Mr. Treasurer, to the first reading. This is all in first reading without reference to any committee. Hearing that, first reading resolved.
Section 1, extension of risk resolved. Pursuant to the provisions.
Chair, extension of risk resolved. Pursuant to the provisions.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I present House Amendment A with a filing number of H-505 to LD-1454 and move its adoption and further wish to speak to my motion. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We've debated the issue around LMF today. It was involved in debate on another bill that was much broader than LMF. So I bring this amendment today really as a way to address a lot of the concerns that were raised before in earlier debate as far as the bill being too broad, as well as future impacts that the bill may have, and that we really focus our efforts on LMF. So I'm here today to offer this amendment to really focus on the issue around LMF, to allow an opportunity for folks to show their support for LMF, to stand strong behind the LMF program. The amendment before you actually focuses exclusively on LMF and does not change future bond issues. And it really does not, it's not in conflict, as we heard earlier, with other issues around conflict in the Constitution. So the amendment was distributed before. Everyone should have a copy on their desk. And it's, you know, it's rather simple. It really requires the governor and the Lands for Maine Future Board to take the appropriate necessary steps to issue the bonds for the Maine, the Lands for Maine Future program. And it really moves the issue forward. And this is really, hopefully, some of the stability that a lot of the folks out there in the land trust community and beyond the land trust community need to sort of feel comfortable moving forward with their land acquisition. And I hope that the folks will join me in supporting this issue today so that we can send a clear message to folks around the state that we do, in fact, in a bipartisan manner, support the LMF program. So thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Chair, can I represent the new board of the
and the secrets in place of the House. I assume most of you have in front of you what I see is House Amendment A in regards to this. But I can see first and foremost of the underlying bill. The underlying bill of Supplement 4, which is resolved and authorized in the balance of 2009 bond issue for the conservation projects, that bond was put forward by the Chief Executive.
This is speaker. Representative Carter, the Chair requires by the President, the Director, Mr. Brian Riley.
A good friend from my new book is speaking to the bill, not to the amendment.
states approval by the governor resolve that the governor or the governor's assignees shall sign all necessary financial orders, project agreements, and other paperwork requested by the land release future where necessary to implement the borrowing authority by the court pursuant to Section 3. I think this is precisely the kind of legislation that is really disenfranchised lots of well-meaning pieces of legislation. I don't believe we have the authority, the legal authority under the Constitution, to direct the governor, to tell the governor, that the governor shall sign all necessary financial orders. Think about that. We're now going to sit here, we're going to try to vote on amendments we've seen now about 15 seconds. And we're going to tell the governor that he needs to sit down and he has to start signing his names with a piece of paper. It's blatantly unconstitutional. Blatantly unconstitutional. I am quite frankly disappointed. I am disappointed in this piece of legislation. Where we do have an important issue that we are trying to deal with the land surveyors future. We are trying to do that. We worked for that this session, and we dealt with part of it today, and Chief Executive, I think in a measure of good present the bill, which has now been replaced with language that's, in my eyes, blatantly unconstitutional. And I think that hurts what it is that we're trying to achieve. We're trying to achieve getting done what is important for the land's remaining future. It's a bill I supported when it was on the floor of the House 5 years ago. So I'm not opposed to doing the right thing and trying to get us to where we need to be. But this doesn't get us there. This doesn't get us there at all. This is merely a continuation of what we've experienced for the last 6 months. We can, we are going to get this right. We will get the lands for Maine's future done in a way that needs to be done for people in Maine. We owe that to the people of the state of Maine, but it needs to be done in a proper way. This is not the proper way, ladies and gentlemen of the House. Mr. Speaker, I request a roll call.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I just wanted to clarify something that that was raised. This is simply about the Lands for Maine Future program. It is limited to the LMF program. It is not having to do with all financial orders by any means. And I would agree with the good representative from Newport, Representative Fredette, that in that essence, you know, that would be a much broader scope for this body to take up. This really is about specific to the LMF program, specific to the concerns that were raised today, previous days, as well as the good representative from Newport referred to, over the last 6 months. And it's really about moving the issue forward for Lands for Maine Future. This is work that was generated in collaboration with folks that are active in the LMF movement around the state to really bring forward something that can continue to move the projects forward and really address concerns that the folks back home have. People in this body have heard from a number of constituents, a number of projects that are really on hold pending sort of action of LMF, and this seemed like the appropriate step to take at this time. So thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Legislature, when this was passed in 1991, told the executive branch that they must companies are not in statute today. We weren't able to amend it, so it remains in statute. So I find it a little ironic that the argument of constitutionality is being used against the language in this particular amendment before us. And that's why we're going to be frustrated in this domain. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair, Mr. Representative from Rhode Island, Representative Barrett.
Mr. Speaker, may I ask a question to the chair? Mr. Speaker, the last few weeks we heard a lot about German sign or die and vetoes and everything else. If this bill was to pass, would this be subject to a veto, which the chief executive would have 10 days? And does that also mean that we do not adjourn sign or die today?
This debate is about constitutional.
Mr. Speaker. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise to answer the question. The board is made up by representatives and nominees of the governor that are drawing a blank on the term at this point in the afternoon, but they are actually confirmed by the Senate after a hearing before the Ag Conservation and Forestry Committee, and those are appointees by the governor. And then there's also appointees that serve on the board. Those are the appointees that are the commissioners of the natural resource agencies, IFNW, Ag Conservation and Forestry, Marine Resources. So they are folks that we know.
Chair, can I just represent the supplier representative of the department?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, just to respond to a comment made by my good friend, the representative from Newport, who suggested that no one in this body knew the members of the LMF board vote. They helped out Patrick Keller, Walt Wilkin, James Foreman, James Norris, General Wilcock, and Neil Piper.
Thank you. Chair, can I direct to the Turner? Chair, is there? Roll call is in order. Any questions about the House of NA? Is not there any question? All the chair will yes. The vote is no. Chair will vote. The House of NA will be there today.
Thank you.
Representative Bernard,